Our next speaker is Anne Vogt, architect Anne Vogt. She worked in Mexico and Venezuela. For the last 9 years she has been working and living in Madrid, and she is now working for the international relations of the Spanish Passive House Forum, and I would like to welcome her.
Okay, thank you, Annabel, for the presentation. My name is Anne Vogt. I'm an architect, and I'm now the vocal of international relations of PEP, which is the Spanish Passive House platform. I'm living in Madrid since 9 years. I studied in Germany, but I specialized in bioclimatic architecture. I was much more interested in the bioclimatic strategies which are used in Mexico and Venezuela. And then when I began to work by my own, I recognized that the Passive House standard in reality is the bioclimatic architect, but in the highest efficiency, let's say it like this. So since 2007, I've worked only in the Passive House standard, and I'm a member of PEP since the first year of existence, and since the second year I'm a vocal. So thank you very much for the invitation. I've been here last year too, and I presented a similar presentation, but now I think in the last year we experienced a boom in Spain of projects and, well, in general, the Passive House movement in Spain. So, well, I wanted to begin again with this with these pictures. Just to ask you if we have similar architecture which could be compared to Passive House in our countries, in Portugal or in Spain. Because in other countries, like in Iceland, there were traditional Passive Houses in Iceland which were insulated with stuff. And as you know, or as you probably know, one of the first Passive Houses is a ship. If you don't know it, you can read here in Passipedia. And one of the examples in Spain, which is more closely to the Passive House standard in the vernacular architecture, is the picture on the left, which are the caves. There are a lot of caves in Spain which are still inhabited, in the north, in the center, and in the south too. And it's really embarrassing for us architects, because in a lot of towns where there are caves, people who live in the town, in a normal house, in a normal flat, in a normal house, they spend the winter with extreme temperatures in the caves, and the summer too. So it's very bad news that the buildings we are doing are less comfortable than the caves. So I think it's a very good example. The problem all these examples have is the ventilation and the illumination. So the Spanish Passive House platform was founded in 2008. And it's a non-profit organization, and we already did 6 national conferences. The last one was last week. I think there were some people, some members of the of your platform too, and about 350 persons attended the conference, and it was really interesting. About the national conference, we do 4 meetings every year about technical conferences. This year it was about 8 meetings. So how was the evolution of PEP in Spain? It was founded in 2008, only 2 delegations and 5 founder members. And now we have 17 delegations in all the country. We have more than 350 members, a newsletter with more than 1,500 subscriptions. Then 87 certified Passive House designers right now, 23 Passive House tradespersons. Well, I congratulate you that you have even more tradespersons than in Spain. And we are more people in Spain, but it's very good news. I was really impressed about the numbers João showed this morning. And we have 16 buildings published in the international database, but we have only 8 certified buildings. And in fact, we are always very careful when we present. We only present projects which are certified or published in the international database, because there are lots of people who say they do passive house and they calculate passive house, but it's not true. So I will only show certified passive houses today. But for the conference, we asked our members of how many passive house projects they are working on or they will do in the next year. And they sent us 114 projects. So we did a map of this 114 projects, and they are very close to the passive house standard. And there are some of them which are quite big projects. Up to now, we have only single family houses which are certified, but there are really big projects coming next year. I hope to show it to you next year in the next conference. So one of the international works that PEP does is are the European projects. This is the European project, as Susanne told you, which is called Eurofit, which is NFIT retrofitting, but step by step. Because we see, especially in Spain, that we normally the promoters don't have money to do a very good passive house retrofitting. So when they want to do it, they do it with less money, and so they do it. For example, they buy windows which are not the best windows, and so if you don't do the best solution, you won't do it in the next 20 or 30 or 40 years if you're talking about windows. So it's very important to plan projects step by step with the money you have now, the first step, and then think of all the details of how you can adapt the next steps in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years, and not to block this evolution to do the best retrofitting, which is Europe, which is NFIT, which is passive house for retrofitting. So we are 14 partners from 11 countries in this project. We started last April, and we're now halfway. This is a map of the case studies of the pilot projects we are working on. I will present to you three of them of Spain. So these are the three projects we have in Spain. The first ones, the first two are in the north of Spain, in Asturias and then in Santander in the north. And the last one is a very big project in Madrid. I will show each of them to you. So this is the first one. It's called La Santina, and it's a therapeutic center for people with problems with alcohol. So it's a quite complex building. The form factor is very bad. And the first step, which is finishing now, is the adaptation of the existing building to the new use, the new distribution, and an enlargement, because they needed more space. And they improved till fitting the NFIT standard, the ground on the first floor, except the kitchen, because it was too difficult, and they minimized a lot of thermal breaches. And the second step will be to improve the kitchen too, and the basement, to meeting the passive house standard, and incorporate the renewable energies. So the first step is finishing now, and the next step will be in a few years. This is the second project. It's a very small single-family house in Santander, in the city of Santander. And the first step is taking place right now. It's nearly finishing the retrofitting now, which was the enhancement of the foundation and insulation below the concrete slab, insulation of roofs and walls, minimization of thermal breaches, and change of windows. It's now just changing the windows. And the second step will be to improve the air tightness, and if you improve the air tightness, you always have to improve the ventilation. So it will be the next step. And then in the last step, the renewable energies, the incorporation of renewable energies. I didn't say it before because we have two different methods to do a step-by-step retrofitting. The first one, La Santina, was by parts of the building. So first one of the parts of the building will be retrofitted, and then the other one. And in the last one, in the small house, it was by components. And this project is by components too. It's the most common one in this European project. It's a quite big hotel. It's a hotel and apartment block with more than 300 flats. And the first step, which will begin in the spring, is the improvement of the thermal envelope of the rooms, insulation and windows. It's a quite big project. They will substitute the cooling machines too, the circulation pumps, new kettle, illumination, a central control monitoring system, and maintenance strategies. I'll show it a little bit in detail. This is the what we found, what the building is like now. It's very, very bad quality, and this is for a hotel. Very bad news, because the clients who want to stay a night or some nights in a hotel don't want to be with a very small comfort zone. It's very important to improve the facade. We did a blower door test, and the result was 14.75. So it's very bad air tightness. And this is what we are going to begin in spring. All the facade will be insulated, and new windows will be installed. And it's interesting because it's the first project in Spain we know that includes the retrofit of a thermal envelope with the energy performance contracting, which is financed by an energy service model, and energy efficiency is found. So it's not like a prototype, but it's really it's reality, and it's the numbers are so good that an energy efficiency fund will do all the financing. It's really interesting because the client doesn't have to pay anything. This is the second European project members of PEP are working on. It is called PASREC, which is 14 partners too in 11 countries. It began 1 year before, so it will finish, I think, in half a year, in 1 year. And several members of PEP are participating with beacon projects in this European project. These are the projects we have. On the left hand, it's a traditional Andalusian traditional terraced patio house, which is being built in Sevilla. It's beginning now. On the top we have, these are two on the islands of Spain. This is in Tenerife, in the Canarian Islands, a single family house, which the construction started right now. And the last one is in Mallorca, in the Balearic Islands, which is finished already, but I didn't have the photos here. So it's interesting because we don't have any heating demand in Tenerife. It's a very good climate, it's a very happy climate, as they say in the Bessifaus Institute. But in Mallorca, it wasn't that easy. Mallorca is not a climate which is very easy. We have a quite big heating load. The heating demand is okay, but the load is quite high. It's not 15 kilowatt hours, it's 10 watt per square meters, but it's like 22 watt per square meters. Quite interesting. Another working group, Pep is co-founder of the Mediterranean Working Group, together with the Portuguese platform. And Sefe in Italy, we are one of the co-founders of a Mediterranean Working Group. And in 2 weeks in Greece, we will have the first Mediterranean conference focusing on the themes which are important for us, like the tourism, hotels, and of course the climate of the Mediterranean. And we also organize the International Bessifaus Days in summer. These are the International Bessifaus in winter. They exist, I think it was the year 11 this year, and I just wanted to show you the projects in Spain which participated this November, just some weeks ago. All over the world, hundreds of buildings participated, and in Spain, these eight or nine projects, the center and in the north of the country. I will present afterwards the projects to you. So, four years ago, we thought that it's not only important to open the peasant houses in winter, but also in summer, to see that even in summer, the comfort is much higher than in a normal house. So, we organized in the last 4 years peasant houses in summer too. This is the map of the members of IFA. We are as the Portuguese platform. We are an affiliate of IFA, so automatically we are all members of the International Passive House Association. And it's quite interesting because PEP is the second largest association in the world right now, the Passive House Association. The first one is Germany, and the second one is PEP. Another international activity, every 2 years we organize an Ibero-American Passive House Award, because we have very small, well, very little certified buildings, so we thought that it's interesting to show projects which are very close to fulfill the standard, or which are not certified and fulfill the standard. So, these are the results of the first Ibero-American Passive House Award. You see here the project in Portugal, the first certified projects in Portugal. We had projects from Chile too. This is a bank in Chile. This is the project in Mexico, as Susanna showed before. Well, in different types of buildings. And this was the first prize, which is a retrofitting of a protected facade in Catalonia. A single family house. You can see all these projects on our platform. On our platform, all the posters of the conference are published. These are the results of the second Ibero-American award from last year. The winner is a big building block in Vitoria. They are just waiting for the license. They will begin, well, I think next month or 2 months. But there are also industrial buildings like this, which is an Olaf mill, or this, which is an industrial building too. Retrofitting, one in Barcelona. This one is in Segovia. The Mexican one participated again. And even a single family house with a swimming pool. So the next edition of the Ibero-American Passive House Award will be next year for the next conference, which will be in autumn next year in Barcelona. So I would like to invite all of you to participate with your project in this award. Members of PEP I organized with Michelle Asouf the first Passive House course in Chile, which was really interesting because there were lots of people from Chile, Argentina, Uruguay, Peru, Colombia, Venezuela, Mexico, Panama and Guatemala. So not only from Chile, but from all over the continent. We did train-to-trainer courses in Mexico too. Nuria Diaz and me helped to the Passive House Institute to do courses in Mexico City for the DEVI program, which is like an adaptation of the PHPP for social housing in Mexico. And these are the projects which are now published in the international database from Spain and in our database in our website. In our website, I'll present them to you briefly. This is the first passive house which was certified in Spain. It's made of ship containers, recycled containers. So it's a special building, not very typical, but it's interesting and it functions very, very well. It's monitored and it's really functioning well. This is the second certified project in Spain. It's a wood construction, but it was necessary to use stone in the facades. So that's why it looks like this. You can see all these projects on our website too. This is the third one. It's a massive wood construction, as you see outside, KLH, for example. Well, I think it was the same. It was the same firm. And it's interesting because it combines the passive house with all the ecological materials. It's only materials which have an eco certification. This is a very different project. The promoter normally works doesn't do single family houses, but apartment blocks, which was the winner of the second award I showed before. And they wanted to test in three single family houses how to do how to adapt their construction type in the passive house standard. So they did these three buildings, which are concrete, with concrete finishing. This is a retrofitting in Barcelona, a very small one, a wood construction. And we just saw in the conference the results of the monitoring, and it doesn't have thermal mass, but it's really functioning very well, even in summer. This is another wood construction, insulated with sheep wool, which was constructed in 2009, with a small patio, and it's a massive concrete basement and a light wood structure. And this is the winner of the first Passive House Award. It's a protected facade and an enlargement in the light wood structure with a sheep wool as an insulation sheet. Well, this is another wood structure, which is a certified building, a quite small single family house. And this is a retrofitting I did as an architect, which is an old building from the 18th century, which is retrofitted with a passive house standard. And it's really functioning really good. We visited in the passive house days, and the favorite place of the owner is next to the window facing north, and next to the walls of the 18th century. So normally it's a place in a normal house you wouldn't use because of the less comfort it has, but in this case it's favorite place. And this is an interesting example because it's made out of straw. It's straw bales, and it was just certified, I think, some weeks ago. It's in Catalonia, to the north. I already showed you this project. It's in Santander, one of the case studies of Eurofit. So this was the first step of the step-by-step retrofitting, which was insulation of the foundation and roof and walls. This one is interesting because we will finish it in only 6 weeks because it was all prepared in a workshop. It's a massive wood construction with wood fiber insulation too. And we began the construction on the construction site on the 20th of October, and we'll finish next week. So I think it's an interesting example. If you don't have a lot of time, it is much easier to work in a workshop, to do a good air tightness job and to insulate very well in the workshop than on the construction site. It's near Madrid. Well, this is of the same firm, another project they did a little bit more in the north. And this is an example which is close to the one which we constructed in 6 weeks, but it's a Finnish wood system. They are doing, well, they have several firms which work in Spain, and it's a prototype from Finland they are representing here. It's not certified yet. And the last one I wanted to show you is a very big single-family house. It has nearly 1,000 square meters, and it has a swimming pool inside. So it was very, very complicated, but it fulfills the Besserfaus criteria. But the airtightness is a little problem, but I think we'll fix it. So I would like to finish this presentation with an image. Well, I finished last year the same way. Some of you already know me. To encourage you to use the most complex and fascinating technology in the world, which is the human brain. Because it's really important. You cannot use the Besserfaus standard without studying it, without understanding it, and without adapting it to your climate, to your culture, and to your local conditions. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Anna. I think that was also a very, very good presentation, specifically because it showed that a passive house standard can be applied to various kinds of materials. You are not forced to work with a specific kind of construction. There are different principles that can be applied, and Anne showed very nicely the variety that we can approach.